Hello, welcome back to Fast Charge. This week I'm joined once again by David Price from Macworld.
Hello, Dom.
Hi, and also Evelina Galli making her debut on the show. She is from our Swedish sister site, M3.
That's me. Hello.
Okay, so we've got a few bits of big news this week, actually, which is nice after... So last week was big, and before that it was slow for a while, I'll admit. This week we've had the launch of the Motorola Edge and Edge Plus, which is kind of exciting just because it's the first flagships Motorola has made in forever. Beyond that, we have some kind of promising design leaks from the iPhone 12 and 12 Pro. And finally, the LG Velvet, which we didn't have time to talk about last week, but that worked out okay because LG has revealed some more info on it over the past 7 days, so we can break it all down right here. Okay, so first up, the Motorola Edge and Edge Plus. I actually can't remember what the last Motorola flagship was. I guess it was the modular Z5 or something like that, which was sort of 2 or 3 years ago, if I'm getting my model numbers right. Maybe it's the Z4. Anyway, they went big on modular phones, those things you could slot in and slot out. It didn't work. They then stopped making flagships at all for a while. The Motorola Razr, their foldable clamshell thing, is kind of flagshipy. It's certainly flagship priced, but not really flagship spec'd. But the Edge and Edge Plus are like flagships through and through, like from the price tag down to like the core specs, which are actually really impressive. And I've been really pleasantly surprised. Evelina, what do you think of it so far from what we've seen?
Yeah, so obviously this is so new right now, we don't really know the price point exactly of these phones. But yeah, like you said, it's definitely a flagship. Personally, I think it's such a difficult segment to get into right now. Mm-hmm. There are so many strong players. And as consumers, we tend to not change if we're already, you know, if you're a Samsung user, you're going to use that. If you like OnePlus, you're going to use that. And Motorola is something we think of as, you know, mid-range to budget phones. So it's going to be interesting to see if they can break that, if they're going to have like the PR campaign of the decade and get into that segment.
What's reassured me is that obviously we've known for a while that they were going to make a flagship. There were rumors for a long time, and then they eventually confirmed it would be happening. And I think with this launch timing, it was probably meant to be an MWC phone in February. So it's all been delayed, but we've kind of known for a while this was coming. I really had the fear that it was going to be that kind of Nokia-style, almost a flagship. Like, not quite the top-end processor, not quite the best cameras, but still getting up to flagship price, and they were going to call it a flagship, but we were all going to say, it's not really. And just like, you know, headline specs here, it's a Snapdragon 865, so that's the top Android processor you can get right now. 12 gigabytes of DDR5 RAM, which again is almost the most you're going to get in a phone. It has 5G, obviously, both millimeter wave and sub 6. It's got a 90 hertz refresh rate, a really big 6.7-inch curved display, triple camera with 108 megapixel main sensor. So all of these are the kind of things that are, you know, top tier phones. They haven't really missed out on anything. They haven't skimped anywhere, which is kind of reassuring. Equally, there's nothing about it that's really unique.
No, right? They don't have a unique selling point at all.
The closest thing to that is that it's a $1,000 phone that still has a headphone jack.
And also quite a big battery as well.
That's true, actually. I mean, they're saying it's the biggest battery in a 5G phone, which is technically true in that it's the same size battery as the S20 Ultra, and probably something else, I'm not sure. But, you know, that it's currently tied for biggest battery in a 5G phone. So battery life should be good, and should be better than the Ultra because it's Snapdragon everywhere, and it's a slightly smaller display, and it's 90 hertz rather than 120 hertz. So actually, a 5,000 milliamp hour battery should mean comfortably a day of use, which the Ultra was... but other than that, there's nothing about it that's distinctive. Although I like the look of it quite a lot, and they've gone for nice color finishes. I actually want to call out the fact that they've gone for really good color names in that kind of breed of really dumb color names. So if you get this proper flagship Edge Plus, you get to pick between Thunder Gray, which is actually kind of blue, and my absolute favorite, Smoky Sangria, which is
a kind terrible dog. these are the worst names I've ever heard.
It's better than, I can't remember what phone it was now, something the other week was Classy White. I honestly went out of my head what phone that was.
Classy, you're not classy.
I think maybe that was the LG V60 was classy white, but I'm not sure. But then if you, it's a bit more boring on the regular Edge, which is solar black or midnight magenta.
How does solar black even work, Dom?
It's the black of a solar eclipse, David.
Right.
I have no idea. My best guess is what they're getting at there is the fact that on the Edge, though weirdly not the more expensive Edge Plus, if you look at some of the photos, there's almost a like rainbowy tint to the curved edges. So the way they've curved the glass means it does sort of reflect nicely, but just on the curved edges, unless that's just a really clever trick of their product photography, because I haven't seen one in person. But it looks like it has a nice like rainbowy finish just at the sides, though that's not on the Edge Plus, which is a bit weird. So there's an Edge and an Edge Plus. The Edge, you're basically dropping the battery size down a bit. The camera goes from 108 to 64 megapixel, but then they both still have the same telephoto and ultra-wide options. It's a Snapdragon 765 rather than 865, so it'll be slower, but it's still got 5G support, though not millimeter wave, just sub-6. Less RAM, slightly less storage, no wireless charging on the regular Edge, but you do get it on the Plus. And less waterproof. It's IP54 versus IP68. They're basically the same design and the same size. You just kind of, it's almost every spec has a slight drop down on the Edge, which is kind of an interesting way to do it. We haven't actually seen that many people do it that way with different parts of the same line, especially the processor drop. I wonder if that's going to confuse people a bit, because I think people are generally used to, if they have something with the same name, it's going to have the same internals, with the exception of like light models or something. But
you're just getting the Edge, right?
Hmm?
You're just getting the Edge.
Yeah, it's also slightly confusing market. So as far as we're aware, in the UK, we get the Edge, but we don't get the Edge Plus. Sweden will be getting the Edge Plus. I don't know if you're getting the Edge or not.
I think we get both, I'm not sure. But I find it funny that we're, for once, one of the places that gets the high-end phones.
Mm-hmm. And then the US is getting both, but they get the Edge Plus in May, and the regular Edge is summer, whenever that will be. So, yeah, it's a slightly odd release strategy. Things are staggered. I'm not even sure what time we get the Edge here, since that's the only one we get. I don't know if that means we get it now or if we're also getting it in the summer. I would guess this is fundamentally just a question of stock shortages. Presumably they just don't have enough of these things, which I suspect is also why the launch has been pushed back, given we've been hearing about Motorola Edge for 3 months or something like that. So they probably just don't have enough. But I'm actually kind of impressed, and especially the price. So again, I don't have UK Edge Plus pricing. But in the US, the Plus model is $999, which basically puts it with the OnePlus 8 Pro and kind of around the same line as the regular Galaxy S20, but down from the Ultra. But given you're getting like the 108 megapixel main lens, that huge battery, it can shoot 6K video, not 8K, but 8K on the S20s was terrible. So that makes sense. You can probably handle 6K better. Like, everything you're getting in this, I actually think is really good. It's maybe a shame it's 90 hertz rather than 120, but I don't think that matters that much.
I'm just having a difficult time seeing who will buy it. I think maybe, even if this one gets great reviews, I'm not sure there's a big market for it. Maybe, though, the next generation, when they've sort of established themselves as flagship makers, maybe that generation will go better, but I'm not sure about this first one.
I kind of get it. I think you're right when you say that people tend to stick with a brand, right? As much as possible. If they can, they'll just go for the new model in the brand they already have. And so Motorola's kind of missed the window to be catching people who used to own Motorola flagships and want a new one.
Yeah.
I think the strategy was probably make everyone fall in love with the Razr and then wow them with a real flagship. And that would have been great if everyone had loved the Razr, but they didn't because it wasn't that good and was very expensive and a lot of them broke. So they've kind of shot themselves in the foot by trying to do the lead up to like, we're back in flagship by doing this like exciting retro thing. And then it didn't really work out that well. Like, they won't even give us a razor to try, I think, because they're maybe worried it will just break on us or something. Yeah, I think you're right. I think this is going to be a really one of those things where it will be one of the best phones that no one really buys this year, which is a shame.
Is there a sense, Dom, that now is not a good time to be releasing a flagship phone?
Oh, yeah, deeply. They were presumably planning to do this earlier this year, and once they've got it made and ready to go, at some point you've just got to go ahead with it. But it is hard. I think there's definitely reduced interest in flagships right now for obvious reasons. People aren't looking to spend £1,000 on a phone. I think that's why it's perfect timing for the iPhone SE, because this is exactly the time that people are looking at cutting cost places. And even if you are ready to buy a new phone, you're probably, if that's a place you can save a few hundred quid, that is going to make sense for a lot of people right now. So I think especially a brand that's essentially new to flagships, given how long they've been out of it, again, it's a really hard sell to say you should spend £1,000 on a Motorola. I think a lot of people are going to not. But we'll see. I mean, like I said, it's out. It's not out for another month. Anyway, it's in mid-May. It comes out in the US at least. So there's a little bit of time for things to maybe get slightly more normal, but I don't know. But I am pleasantly surprised. I hope they, even if this doesn't do that well, I hope this is a signal of Motorola that they're going to at least put a few years into trying to make phones at this price and at the price that the Edge is at, which is at the sort of 500, 600 mark, because that makes sense. And I think they can do well there. Their budget stuff is still really good. I just, you know, had the Moto G8 Power the other week. I've got the G8 Power Lite coming in soon. And I'm always impressed by the G series stuff. And I think they make such good cheap phones that there's no reason they can't make good expensive phones. They just need to convince people that they're a premium brand again. And that's going to be, like you said, Evelina, it's a PR thing at this point for them more than the phone. Unless it turns out the camera's rubbish in person or something, the phone looks like it's really, really good on paper and really good value. But they've just got to convince a few million people of that, which I don't envy them. That is probably about all we've got to say about the Edge stuff. So I think let's move on to iPhone. So David, you're going to know a lot more than me about this, but my understanding is we've basically had a leak that suggests that the next iPhone series, post SE, is going to look a bit more like the latest iPad Pros. Is that a fair way of putting it?
Yeah, that's part of it. We've been saying this for a while, that the iPad Pro sort of design language will be transferred across to the iPhone, so you've got those slightly more squared off edges. We've had that for a while, actually. About 2018 was the first iPad Pro with no home button, and it had that squared off edge. So somebody sent in CAD schematics of the iPhone 12 Pro Max to a guy called Max Weinbach, who's a leaker. And then he sent that to a guy who has a YouTube channel, and he printed it out, you know, 3D printed it. And it's, to be honest, you see it and you think that's pretty similar to the iPhone 11 Pro Max. Because you know what, we get into this sort of inside baseball thing where we're all debating small details, and it is interesting. Like there are like multiple changes from the iPhone 11 Pro Max, but it's essentially a very similar design. It's more squared off on the corners. The cameras on the back have been sort of reconfigured a bit. So it was, I didn't even realize this, it was a rectangle. The array that the three camera lenses on the back of the iPhone 11 Pro Max and 11 Pro is slightly elongated, and that's now an actual square. And there's now four sensors in there, but only three of them are camera lenses. The fourth one is LiDAR, which is the sensor none of us had heard of until a few months ago. I'm sure lots of people have heard of it. I wasn't familiar with LiDAR until they started talking about it in the iPad Pro 2020. But other than that, it's pretty similar. So it's not exactly incendiary, is what I'm trying to say.
The front notch is meant to get a bit smaller as well. Is that right?
Yeah. They're not sure. So there's a lot of wiggle room in this leak, I'll tell you, Dom. So he said that he first of all said that the it's 70% sort of accurate, 70% finished. Because you've got to bear in mind, it's still a while before this is going to come out. And he said that the camera stuff is wrong for security reasons. I'm fascinated by this sort of stuff because, you know, that Apple, very very famously secretive company,
yeah,
which isn't really working as well as it used to because everybody's working from home. So they're having to send out prototypes to all their engineers in their homes, which is far more opportunities for this stuff to get out. But it's like they did it, you know, about trap streets in maps.
Yeah.
They deliberately put in, oh, this is made up street. And then just to see if anybody else copies it, and then they'll know that they copied their map. So I assume that's it. But if that's it, you'd have to do it differently for each schematic. And then you'd be able to identify the source. And he's perfectly happy. Well, my source is not going to get caught out here. So I don't really understand how that's a security measure if it's just wrong on all of them. But okay.
Anyway. Just sending all their own engineers the wrong information.
Yes. I can't remember what I was started off talking about. Oh, yeah, the notch. Yeah, so he's not sure. He did multiple different printouts with different degrees of shrinkage in of the notch, right? So some of them it's like almost approaching the teardrop notch, which is on one of the phones you sent me to read about for today. I can't remember which one.
That's the LG one we'll be getting to in a bit.
Which I'm not so keen on that. But, I mean, personally, I'm sorry, I'm just talking for ages here. Personally, I'm not keen on the idea of the notch being smaller. I think, yeah, 100%. I think you lean in on this stuff. I think they did it. Then you say it's not a bug, it's a feature. This is our thing. This is our iconic design. Mm-hmm. It replaces the home button. I remember Chris Finn had this really great theory that when they went from the home button, which is a really identifiable, that is an iPhone, a little circle with the square in it, or circle with a squircle in it, completely identifiable, that was gone. So people couldn't instinctively see a device and think, well, that's an iPhone. And so instead there was the notch, and they didn't do it because of that, but it was quite a nice side effect. But now if they get rid of it, that's great. And then they can say, well, courage, you know, big step forward, insanely great. But if they just make it smaller, then that's like admitting it wasn't very good. And then, well, we made it a bit better, but we still haven't got rid of it. It's still there, but it's just not quite as rubbish. I don't know. I think they should have gone all in and just kept it or got rid of it completely when they're able to do that.
I think I agree. I think it makes more sense for them to keep that as a recognizably iPhone thing, because of course there was, when the 10 came out, for the next year every Android phone had exactly the same notch setup, but then all the Android manufacturers have done their best to shrink the notch down to a teardrop, or get rid of it and have a pop-up, or turn it into a pinhole camera. So now the iPhone is the only phone left that has that big wide notch, and so it is an iPhone thing, and that makes sense, and that's a very Apple thing to just hang on to it for that. And I think the same reason, I think they'll just hang on to it until they're ready to do a proper under-display camera setup. They'll keep the big chunky notch, or at least something that looks roughly like it. The downside for them is they pack so many sensors in there to make their Face ID really good, that actually they're going to have so many more technical challenges to putting it under the display than most Android companies. So Android will have those working under-display ones first, because so many Android phones just put a single selfie lens on the front anyway and don't bother with the rest. So that's much easier, whereas I suspect Apple will sort of inevitably lag behind in doing proper under display. So if they go that way, it could still be a big fat notch for another 3 years, which I guess is the point where they maybe start to worry. But short of ditching some of their sensors, they don't really have many other options.
Yeah, and the quality of Face ID is a big selling point, I think.
Yeah, and it's worth it. Yeah. Nothing on Android can match Face ID. None of the Android face unlocks are anywhere near that good or secure. So I get that they stick with it. And again, they're Apple, so they can get away with it. Any Android manufacturer who still has a big fat notch like that on their flagship would get rinsed for it. But it's Apple, so it's fine, because it looks like an iPhone, and that in itself makes it look good.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I should say I've played this down a little bit this leak. The screen is bigger. Not by a lot. So it was 6.5 inches before, and it's 6.7 inches now. And they've done that by a sort of pincer movement. They've made the bezel smaller, but they've also made the chassis itself a little bit wider, a little bit taller. But it's flatter. It's thinner as well.
Okay.
And
again, that makes sense in terms of what other brands are doing. And that is one area where I think they were lagging a bit behind. Their bezels were still pretty pretty thick.
Yeah, for an all-screen design,
yeah,
the screen-to-body ratio isn't actually that great on the iPhone 11 Pro.
But luckily, they have resisted the urge to go in for curved displays. That's one thing the Motorola we didn't talk about. Like they're calling it the Edge, partly because the edges of the screens are like curves almost 90 degrees around or something, some nonsense like that. So you have this unusable curved edge. It is my pet peeve of a lot of Android flagships, so that is the way things are going. And I love that Samsung drew back from it this year. It is a little bit of reassurance that Apple has clearly just always looked at those kind of curved panels and just, nah.
Yeah, I'm not keen on that thing. I mean,
yeah,
it feels gimmicky. It's interesting looking, but yeah, I don't think I'd like it.
They're flashy, but at the price... Oh, sorry.
No, you go ahead.
I was just going to say, they're flashy, but at the price of usability, which I think is the kind of Apple prioritizes that the other way around. They like flashy things, obviously, but not if it's going to get in the way of the user experience or like confuse your nan.
Sure. I'm wondering if the new design will make them less slippery too, like easier to hold in your hand, because basically modern phones are soaps right now. So I'm wondering if this sort of, because I loved my iPhone 4 and 5. I don't miss them, but I like the new design. So I'm wondering if this one will make them less slippery to hold, although kind of slightly more difficult to put in girls' jeans pockets, which is already a problem with this big phone.
I have a lot of trouble putting them in girls' jeans. I
never, never goes well for you, does it, David?
Yes, the guy that printed out, he said that it was very comfortable in the hand and it felt futuristic and it felt sleek. Mm. And the word sleek slightly worries me because it sounds good, but it possibly means slip prone. So I don't know. The fact that it's wider troubles me a little bit because I like the iPhone X. I thought that was a really good design and a really good compromise because they took the 7 Plus and they gave it a bigger screen, but it was a significantly smaller device. I like that. And then the next year they come out with the XS Plus and they think, well, why don't we throw away all that stuff we've gained in portability? Mm. Let's just have an even bigger screen. I know this in Android land, it's all getting into that sort of 6.7 inch territory or bigger. I don't think that's really necessary. And I have an 11 Pro. So I think the biggest screens, I personally don't like them. I know they're quite good for gaming, but I worry that this is getting excessive, you know, from a pocketability point of view, exactly.
Hmm. No, but I agree with that.
There are some rumours that there will be like a really very compact iPhone this year, isn't it?
Yeah, well, I think that was just the iPhone SE 2020. Mm. They were talking about these sort of, sort of in-betweener sizes, sort of 5.4 inches and things like that, somewhere between the SE and the 11, but I don't know if that's actually going to happen. I hope it does. I think that would be brilliant. I think smaller phones, I think that's the gap that Apple can tap into.
Yeah, and the Android is mostly neglecting at this point. But I will say on the SE, it's kind of a shame the way this timing looks like it's working out, which is that they're kind of going back to that iPhone 4, iPhone 5 slightly squared off design. And they just released the SE, which had that design in its first iteration, and lots of people wanted it to have that design again. And it may be the last one that actually has the rounded, like, iPhone 8 chassis. And then maybe we're about to get these squared off iPhone 12s, and everyone's going to look and say, well, can the SE have had that?
Yeah, but the iPhone SE is cheaper, so it cannot, by the rules of marketing, it cannot have the latest of anything. So if it was the first to get the new design, that would never work.
But no.
I know what you mean.
Which, again, is a rule that Android manufacturers break all the time, and then it makes the flagship launches really confusing. Samsung basically like gave away the S20 design on the sort of S10 Lite and A51 and A71, which were its like mid-range things it announced at CES. And they had all the design language that then went into the S20 series. So when the S20 arrived, it didn't look exciting and new. It was like, oh, it's like those cheap phones you released 2 months ago. Great. Apple won't fall into that trap, I think. Okay, I mean, that feels like as good a note as any to move on to the LG Velvet, because this is basically all about a new design, a new branding, and a big shift for LG. So LG Velvet is basically the LG have revealed will be their next flagship phone. It's probably what the G9 would have been, but they're just scrapping that. And basically, it sounds like they're entirely giving up on that naming convention they had, which was alphanumeric. So we had the, you know, G6, G7, G8, and then the sort of V30, V40, V50, and we just had the V60. And it sounds like they're just moving away from that entirely. There was a sort of state from them that they're moving away from alphanumerical designations in favor of familiar and expressive names, like Velvet. And Velvet is intended to evoke images of lustrous smoothness and premium softness, two key characteristics of the new phone.
Softness.
A velvety soft phone. I don't know what that means. I don't think it's going to be a soft phone. I'm confident in that.
A fussy phone.
Yeah. It doesn't look fuzzy from the images and the video they've put out. So, yeah, I mean, it looks lovely, though, actually. The naming is interesting. I think it kind of makes sense because the G series and V series got unwieldy. The fact that the Vs went up in tens and the Gs went up in individual units made it really hard to tell what match, at least like Samsung matches its S and Note numbers, so you can always know that they're on a par. LG's, you couldn't tell what matched from the V and the G lines. And honestly, just as a flagship brand, it was kind of dead. No one had that much interest anymore. Velvet will inevitably have the problem of what's the next one called, assuming they each have different noun names. How do you remember which one's the new one and which one's the old one and how many years ago that was? So that will be confusing in its own way. But it will stand out. And that kind of looks like what they're trying to do a bit with the design as well, which my favorite thing about it and the standout thing is definitely the camera array on the back, which they're calling a raindrop camera, which basically just means the four lenses are arrayed vertically with the biggest one at the top, and then they go down in size, and it just kind of looks like a falling drop of water if you squint really hard. But it looks nice, and they're not housed in a big square rectangle block wedge thing like every other phone at the moment. And it looks like they've, you know, picked which lens goes where based on what will look the nicest, which I feel like is a thing even Apple and Samsung have forgotten how to do, and they're just throwing lenses onto phones anywhere they'll fit. But yeah, I mean,
Dom, do you know what are the benefits of having in a vertical array in sort of photographic terms? Because I always found it strange when I'm an Apple guy, when they went from having the two lenses horizontally, which I thought would match, in a sort of biological sense, it would match the stereoscopic human eyes. I thought there must be some benefits to that. And then when they went vertical, I thought, is there some difference to that? Or is that purely a design, what looks nicest point of view?
I suspect. I'm not aware of any difference it would have photographically. I'm ready to be told I'm wrong. I suspect it would be a combination of design and internal space, like where all the internal components are, and that's where you can squeeze camera sensors in, especially because camera sensors are getting bigger, so they take up more space. Otherwise, I mean, I assume part of the move towards the square blocks is to put the lenses closer together as you have more and more lenses, so that when you switch between them, you don't get as much like a perspective shift from the lens being further along the chassis, whereas putting them all together probably makes it look more like they're all shooting from the same spot. But yeah, between vertical and horizontal, I don't know if there's actually any photographic difference. But yeah, otherwise, I mean, it looks like a nice phone. We don't know a whole lot about it. We know it will come in red, black, white, and green. We know it's got that raindrop camera array on the back. We have no idea what those lenses are. We know it's got a teardrop notch on the front, so the little central camera notch that's just a single small lens. It's got a headphone jack and a Google Assistant button. We can tell that from the renders. And basically the only spec thing they've said is that it's a Snapdragon 765G, which is the same processor as the Motorola Edge, the sort of cheaper Edge, which again, 5G chip, but not totally high-end. This actually makes a lot of sense to me. I think it makes sense to Motorola as well. One of the big stories in sort of Android land over the past few months has basically been that the Snapdragon 865 is really expensive, and that Qualcomm is charging a lot for it. I saw a lot of discussion of this after the SE came out, because people were saying it would be like economically impossible to make a phone at the SE price point with the 865, which would be the equivalent to putting in the A13, you know, fastest processor around, because they just, it costs so much to buy those from Qualcomm that you just couldn't make enough money on the phone at that price, which is the perk Apple has in making its own. So the 765G makes sense. It means this will be in that kind of upper mid tier, I guess. You know, £700, $700 rather than a grand, I would hope.
I've heard that LG is going for a very offensive price strategy, though, that they're going to try to be very competitive. So fingers crossed.
That would make sense for them. Again, because I think they're in the same position to Motorola, or similar rather, which is that people have lost a bit of faith in them as a flagship brand.
Yeah.
Unlike Motorola, they've still been making them like two or even three a year. Even more, actually, if you count all the G8 variants we got. So they've been making a lot, but people aren't always buying them. And certainly they've really struggled to even sell them in the UK, as in like the retailers just won't stock them because they've lost faith that people want to buy LG phones. So I think they needed this change of tack. And I think, yeah, going cheaper makes sense. It's, you know, hopefully they're not going to do what Motorola are doing with the Edge Plus, which I think rightly made you nervous that they might not be able to persuade people to drop that kind of money, because they've got to basically find a new customer base. They can't rely on an existing one. There is one thing they are hopefully keeping, but maybe improving, which is there was, I think just today or maybe yesterday, there was a sort of certification notice for a screen case for a new codename LG phone. So that is probably a dual screen case for the Velvet, which is what they've obviously been pushing on the V60, the V50, and the G8X, I want to say. And it's their slightly weird clip-on case that gives you a second screen and kind of gives you like a foldable, but not really, because it's just an accessory case. Have you actually used one of those? David, I'm sure you haven't touched one of these. Dirty Android phone, you wouldn't go near
Certainly
it.
Certainly not.
Evelina, have you used any of the dual screen ones?
No, they haven't come to Sweden yet.
Really?
Yeah.
Yep. I quite like them, and I feel weird about that, because when I first saw the first one, I thought it was the dumbest thing. But actually using them, and the first generation was pretty bad, actually. But they really improved it with the G8X. I've heard the V60 is similarly good. And if they can improve it a bit more, maybe reduce the sort of bezeling a bit, so it looks more like one seamless screen rather than very obviously being two with a big gap between them. But it's great for multitasking. All the benefits, all the practical benefits you get out of having a foldable phone, but without having to pay like a grand and a half or £2,000 to get it, basically. The downside is it makes the phone pretty chunky. And LG was clearly always figuring out whether it was a thing that should be bundled in with the phone or sold separately. And they've gone back and forth with every device, and different markets have had it different ways. And you can tell they just don't really know yet which way works. And I don't know when they ever will figure that out. But it's the thing that I think everyone looks at the LG flagships and says, that's rubbish. And then I think you try it and you kind of go, oh, okay. It's ugly, but it does work.
And presumably...
Sorry,
go ahead, Evelyn. I don't want to talk
No, you go that. Ahead, Evelyn.
All I was going to say is that whenever I see those folding phones, I worry that they're going to break. But if you have an accessory that you buy separately and that breaks, presumably it's much easier just to go back and buy that again. So it's less of a worry.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah, it's an affordable thing to break. You can also take the phone out of it, obviously. So it's also a thing you can take with you when you know you've got a big train journey and you want a nice way of watching TV, but leave at home when you know you just want to have a more compact phone to slip in your pocket all day.
Yeah, I think maybe the most clever way for LG to sort of push this phone is to aim it towards more business users, maybe, like the Fold, sort of for professional users, or like the Note, because I feel like there needs to be some competition on that market right now.
Yeah, it's one of the odd choices in that the way they actually pushed the dual screen before was always more like, you can use one screen as a gamepad, or it's really good for taking selfies. And I never felt like they put enough emphasis on, like, you can have your email on one screen and have your calendar on the other screen, and that's really handy. Or you can actually have, like, you know, if you use Google Docs or Office on your phone, you can have that on one screen. And, you know, it is good for productivity. It's really useful, but it's never been it's not the sexy angle. So that's not what they want to push. But, you know, I do wonder if there's a space for that where they can just kind of say, look, you know, your company doesn't want to drop £2,000 buying you a Galaxy Fold. but it might drop 800 buying you this phone with a second screen, which is also super good for productivity. And again, because it's flexible, you can take it in and out. It could be like, well, I clip the case on a work day when I know I want it for like work multitasking, but I don't when I'm just going out by myself. Not that any of us go out ever, but yeah, I'm intrigued to see what they're doing. We don't know, they're sort of drip feeding info, which makes sense. But I think the expectation is that it'll probably come out in May. And probably knowing our luck, they'll reveal absolutely everything about the phone in the 24 hours between us recording this and putting it live. And we're all going to look like tits. But fingers crossed, no. Hopefully they wait at least a week. But I would really like to see LG keep making good phones, but make good phones people want to buy. And that's kind of where they slipped up. It felt like they kept making the phones they wanted to make, and we're ignoring the fact that the market kept like screaming no at them. And hopefully this is a change. And I really, really, really want to know what premium softness is. Okay, I think that probably wraps it up for today on that slightly unsettling note. Thank you, David and Evelina, for joining me. Everyone who's watching, thank you. Jump in the comments, let us know what you think about these three devices. And obviously, like, subscribe, hit the notification bell, all that kind of stuff. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.